You are listening to the Catholic Thinkers Podcast, a free treasury of instruction in the Catholic intellectual tradition. If you enjoy this lecture, please visit us at catholicthinkers.org/donate.
This is Father James Schall, and I want to continue with a lecture that is entitled Art, Faith, and Creativity. It's a lecture that was scheduled to have been given at the Maritain Conference at LaSalle University in 2012, but was not because I think I was sick at the time. And it will probably be published in their journals, but here I think it might be worthwhile to go over this interesting issue of the relation of art and faith and creativity. The subtitle of this lecture is called On the Artistic Origins of Political Disorder in Modernity. And I want to begin with a citation from Professor Bernard Danhauser's essay on Nietzsche in the History of Political Philosophy, in which he says, quote, "The death of God is the liberation of man from God." This would be Nietzsche's idea. Man can now be loved, be loyal to the earth, as Zarathustra admonished him to be. The heart of the earth is gold. There is no hell. The death of God is the liberation of man from guilt. The death of God is the discovery of man's creativity. The end of the quote from Danhauser, summarizing Nietzsche. The second quotation is from Jacques Maritain's essay called Action and Contemplation. And he says there, quote, so these are two introductory comments that I want you to think about. Christian theology is a theology of divine generosity, of that superabundance of divine being which is manifested in God himself, as only revelation can tell us, in the plurality of persons, and which is manifested, as we could have discovered by reason alone, by the fact that God is love, and that he is the creator. It is not for himself, St. Thomas says, it is for us that God made everything to his glory. Even contemplation superabounds, as in efficacious love and in action. It corresponds within us to that divine superabundance communicative of its own good, the end of the quote. So the superabundance of God manifesting itself in being. So to keep alive the thought of those who have preceded us in one of the functions, is one of the functions of intellect, to keep us alive what has been before. Or perhaps we could better say that thought is always alive, but only if someone thinks it. Thought is always the activity of a person. It never, even in the case of angels or God, stands simply by itself. Thought thinking of itself is, in fact, God, to recall Aristotle's definition of God. We are to think even more deeply on those insights and truths that make us aware of what is in the first place. So when something makes us aware of it, we want to think about it more. It may have been something in our experience or something handed down to us that causes us to begin to think. All thought can be understood, but not all thought corresponds to reality. just because it is thought by someone. Errors continue to be errors, no matter when or where or by whom they are thought. Truths are truths, even if a few ever acknowledge or judge them to be true. The drama of thought includes the outcome of the struggle between truth and error. All being is true, but not all thought about being is true, though it will always have some truth in it. We cannot just think error. Pure error, just as nothing, is in fact unintelligible except as a negative of being. Since our actions flow from our thought, we cannot be indifferent to the truth or falsity of what we think. What we can do, however, is to connect a world that justifies what we want to do, even if what we want to do does not conform to what we ought to do. So we can think about what we ought not to do. The world of thought thus includes the world that seeks to make error plausible in order that we might act as we would on the basis of the error. At first sight, a conference devoted to art and faith will not appear to be likely or a proper forum in which the topic of politics spontaneously arises. Indeed, it should not be broached here unless something is found in the understanding of what art is that might serve either to aid or to understand politics. Behind this consideration lies the issue of the relation of the practical intellect to the theoretical intellect, as we understood it in Aristotle and St. Thomas. If we recall our Aristotle, he discussed in the sixth book of the Ethics the two virtues of the practical intellect under the headings of prudence and art or craft, recta ratio agibilium, the right order of things to be done, and recta ratio factibilium, the right order of things to be made. So one of them would be human beings to be done, and the other one would be art, craft, to make something, even a poem. These two rather innocent-sounding phrases require much a consideration. Indeed, on their proper understandings stands the whole issue of right order of soul and its possibility. Aristotle contrasts these practical virtues with the three theoretical virtues of wisdom, first principles, and science. These latter virtues are concerned only with how things are, with what is. We are content with that knowledge as its own goal, its own good, or its own goal. Indeed, we are delighted simply to know that thing, that things are, and what they are. Such activities are indeed proper to us, human and rational beings, the activities of actually knowing things and rejoicing in them. Our one mind, as Aristotle taught us, is indeed but one mind. However, it operates differently when it considers things that cannot be otherwise and considers those that can be otherwise. Already here, we note that if in our theory all things can be otherwise, we have implicitly excluded the idea that something can be true. For here we are already at the beginnings of that voluntarism, which divine or whether divine or human, that allows nothing to be what it is. In the first case, when we consider things that cannot be otherwise, truth is achieved when the mind conforms to reality, to what is. In the second case, regarding things that can be otherwise, truth is the conformity of the mind with what we ought to do in moral things, or with what we intended to do or to produce in the case of arts and crafts. The mind, as such, does nothing, as Aristotle also tells us. Its primary purpose is simply to know, not to do. Doing human action, or making a chair, for example, follows knowing, not vice versa. Let's say we know the chair idea, what a chair is, before we can make a chair. Something beyond mind is required to go out of mind. This is why we are beings with both minds and hands and wills. It is the human hand that reflects the mind and enables it to move outside of itself. The fact that we do go out of the mind is itself the primary proof that we have both will and mind in their relationship to each other. But both of these need hands, in a sense. Among the things that can be otherwise are the things of material creation. We can make a chair or a computer, but only so long as at the same time, wood remains wood and metal remains metal. We have the power and the tool of the hand to fashion the things of the material universe to conform to our needs and desires. In this sense, some correspondence seems to exist between mind and matter as if they belong to each other. The very structure of our being includes mind and hands. This indicates the truth of this relationship. But among the things that can be otherwise are not only material things, but also our lives. We are the rational beings whose perfection or good seems to include ruling ourselves and others. I'm being ruled by others. And we can do a good or a bad job of it, for which we are to be praised or blamed. We are the one being in the universe whose perfection is not simply given by nature or by instinct. It requires some of its own input for it to be what it is intended to be. Thus, Aristotle says that the truth of the practical intellect in matters of human action is the conformity of our act with what the good man would do in the same circumstances. Although seeking the advice of others is often a good idea, Aristotle does not mean that whenever we want to do something, we should look up this proverbial good man in the neighborhood or online. He meant that in every act we are about to put into reality, we can find within its various possibilities what is correct or worthy to do. We can also choose not to do what seems best or right. we do not create this rightness, but we find its possibilities in being. We recognize it. These considerations are important because they contrast with the truth that is found in things that proceed from art or craft. The goodness of a chair concerns first whether it is, in fact, a chair or not that we set out to make. And secondly, so the first thing we have to do is decide is the chair. And then secondly, we have to decide with whether what peculiar kind of chair that we make, does it correspond to what we intended to make? The truth of art or craft is thus the conformity of the thing made to what is intended to be made. In this sense, art is free to make all sorts of things that do not exist in existential reality, but which can be imagined or pictured or as feasible in some for some purpose. It follows from this capacity that a good artist can be, in another order, a bad man, nor need a good man be a good artist. In the case of prudence, however, the reason element in every act of ruling oneself, family, or polity, its ends, in other words, are not open to our manipulation in the way we can picture things in art. Prudence is the intellectual of the moral virtues, as we saw. It is a judgment about means to an end. First of all, oneself, of the end of oneself, of one family, of one city, and ultimately of our place in the order of things. Unlike art, prudence does not choose the end. The end is rather a task of the speculative order and is given by nature. Human action follows on and pursues the end of human life already implanted within it. And if this end is transcendent, it means that we are not free to change it. We can reject it in practice, but we cannot change it. This possibility of rejecting our proper end is why we can talk of a prudence by which we successfully accomplish bad things, personal or political. But the very accomplishment of what is wrong is itself properly imprudent and a vice. Aristotle tells us that politics is the highest of the practical sciences. Hence, political prudence will correspond to this priority. But politics is not the highest science as such. The practical order relates to the theoretical order. Politics is thus, in this sense, is in the service of what man is. It does not establish what man is. That comes from nature. Politics, taking man from nature as being already man, is responsible assist him in being good man, as Aristotle said. We do not cause ourselves to be men, to be what we are. What it is to be man is already what we are when we come into being. This is true for every actual human being who has ever conceived or lived. We are not the principal architect of our own what is. It is given to us. We are not asked either to exist or to be what we are. Art, however, has a certain likeness to the divinity. Indeed, when Aquinas spoke of creation, he spoke of it as the result of God's practical intellect. And what was created was the result of God's willing a chosen order into existence. This is the order that is open to our intellect in reflecting on ourselves and on the world in which we live. We do not run into an unchosen world when we become aware of it and act in it. We live in a world that is what it already is. But within that world, we have a certain dominion whereby we can fashion what is not ourselves to assist our purposes. In this sense, the world does not simply exist for itself. Its very order is open to intellect. But we cannot fashion ourselves into other beings. We remain human even in everlasting life. What we are, we can understand, but we are already what we are. This fact is why our purpose in life is finally, is fully to become what we are. But this becoming what we are in its complete sense includes our active participation in becoming what we ought to be. Augustine's restless heart remains the primary fact that at some basic level we all realize this orientation of our own individual being to transcendence. Quote, the essential characteristic of art, taken in its complete extension, is to instruct us how to make something so that it is constructed, formed, or arranged as it ought to be, and thus to secure the perfection or goodness not of the maker, but of the object itself which it makes. This is Jacques Maritain's comment about art. He says, art, therefore, belongs to the practical order in the sense that it instructs us how to make something, considering not the use we should make of our free will, but the manner in which the work as such and in itself should be executed. We may thus say that art is concerned with what is to be made. The end of the quote of Maritain. So art concerns what is to be made. The question behind this observation of Maritain is whether man himself is something to be made, or something already made such that what he is, can be discoverable by reason. He is not something he made, but something to be perfected in what he already is, and this by his own agency. Let us suppose, however, that we reverse the priority of art and politics in the understanding of practical intellect. Let us postulate that politics is in fact an art and not a prudence. What follows? In a too little known book, The Structure of Political Thought, Father Charles N. R. McCoy addressed this issue in a careful, profound way. The relation of art and prudence is, in fact, key to the understanding of what Machiavelli is all about in the history of political philosophy, in the history of thought itself. McCoy says, the modern theory of politics begins by reversing the order between prudence and art. It will see a liberty that is proper not to prudence, but to art, by a conformity simply of what the prince actually produces with what he intended to produce. The opening phase of modern political thought avows an indifference to the morally good. It frees man from an obligation to a moral order founded on man's given being, the end of the quote. Prudence concerns means to ends, not ends themselves. This Machiavellian position that permits the prince to use evil a good means for his success is but a first step. If the prince is an artist of the political order, he has the freedom of art when it comes to his practical subject matter, which ought to be to uphold what is right and to reject what is wrong for a human being. But if his subject matter, that is, the free and rational citizens, can be treated as things whose individual ends are not the concern of the prince, then he can treat them all as means to his end without having to consider them as responsible beings. But if the prince is free of the distinction of good and evil, he acquires a new sort of freedom. He can use either good or evil means to achieve his end. He is a successful prince if his political creating conforms to what he wants. He is not to be judged as a by a criterion of an abiding good and evil, but by the good of his creation, which is successful if it is what he wants it to be. McCoy calls this Machiavellian reversal, but the first step it requires raw power to put it into effect. Is there something better? What if the new understanding of man in which he could define himself were not the result of political power, but of a new understanding of nature? Nature itself will be freed from all metaphysical and theological conceptions, McCoy says. The mind would thus not be subject to what is, nor would human beings have to conform to what they ought to do and ought to be. We will reverse the priority of the theoretical and the practical order, and within the practical order, we'll reverse, make art superior to prudence. A new kind of liberty will be sought. Quote, it will seek a liberty that is proper neither to prudence nor to human art, but to divine art. For divine art had always been considered to be the principle of the works of nature, and it will define the good not in terms of an end which man seeks, but rather in terms of the very being of man, which becomes the principle from which all things are made, all things humanly significant, which become the totality of significance. End of the quote. We need to understand the full force of this intellectual background. Man literally replaces God as the cause of what he knows in nature, including our own nature. In this context, we have at our disposal what is, in fact, a divine art. We are free to create any sort of world or human being that we can or want. No other justification is needed other than our very doing it. No nature exists to which we are subject. In effect, following Kant, it is the new science of physics in which this divine artistic world comes forth. Experiential science is getting close to him, getting close to him who made the universe. It is because, this is the quote, it is because the structure of the universe depends upon him, that's on God, made it, that experimental science gets away from the givenness of things as formed to things as formable. You know, let's say we look at the things as already formed and not as simply formable, which would be from the divine power, which would make it what it is. The trouble is that in the present order, we obtain our ideas about what to search for from a science by already existing regularity in matter. So the patterns of nature already exist. This regularity suggests that nature bears an intelligence that is not merely its own, a substitute intelligence, as McCoy calls it. In other words, the human intellect is a receiver, not a maker of what is. Quote, the ultimate point in common between the new physics and the new politics is their unconcern in their aspect of arts for the familiar world of common understanding. End of the quote. We live in a world of common understanding, yet we see in the logic of the premises that McCoy has spelled out that we have, in effect, rid ourselves of this human nature that is given to us. We have substituted a concept of human nature that is subject to nothing but itself. Everything is permitted except the notion that for human beings, that for the human good itself, something is not permitted. The dynamism of the modern world, including often its art, is that of a systematic defiance of the order of things that the divine art established. This defiance is possible, no doubt, because human ends and purposes must be chosen or at least accepted. The divine artist cannot create a free creature and then remove his freedom. He is free, in other words, to defy God and concoct his own world. On this point, the free creature must either accept or reject what he is. If he rejects it, he must logically seek to invent a theory or idea of himself and the world that does not include any of the order that is put there by the divine artist. In the beginning, I cited a comment of Werner Danhauser about Nietzsche, the notion that that the death of God is the foundation of modern creativity. The word is precisely chosen. This creativity of the death of God means that no limits or restriction can be found for what man can do with himself. Whatever he does or makes of himself, provided it is of the result of his own will, is permissible. What is not permissible is to maintain that man and the cosmos are created by God with a given us a superabundance that, when spelled out, is really what is best for man and for the universe itself. The given spiritual challenge of modern man seems to be nothing less than the eventual realization that God looks out better for him than he can look out for himself. How do we think about these things? In an old Peanuts scene, Lucy is sitting on the floor reading her to her younger brother Linus, who is paying close attention to the words. She reads, "And so the king was granted his wish." In the next frame, Lucy continues her reading. "Everything he touched would turn to gold." And then she could do that the next day. In the third scene, Linus suddenly leaps to his feet to shout, "Stop, stop. You don't have to read anymore. I know just what is going to happen." In the final sequence, Linus is walking away with Lucy, simply looking at him. He tells her, "These things always have a way of backfiring. We can evidently, for a time, go ahead and make choices that we are that are contrary to what is. We can even build nations and civilizations on the sun's premises. We are left the freedom to make choices that carry consequences down the ages in both families and in nations." In the book of Ezekiel, we find a famous scene in which the Lord finally consents or not to charge the children for the sins of their fathers. We are to be responsible only for our own sins. And yet, as we know from the doctrine of original sin, the free choices of others will affect us. God does not isolate us from them, from these choices. This is part of their heinousness, but it is also a testament to the respect that God has for our free choices. Things that look so very good will backfire, to cite Linus's words. They won't work even while they're working. In conclusion, I should like to recall another comment of Maritain, one in which he distinguished between poetry and mystical experience. I do this in the context of my argument about art or poetry and a politics that exempts itself from the true ends of man. Quote, "Poetry, a poetic experience, differs in nature from mystical experience," Maritain wrote in his Approaches to God. "It is concerned with," that is to say, a poetic experience is concerned with the created world and with the immeasurable or innumerable enigmatic relations of beings with one another, while mystical experience is concerned with the principle of being, with its unity superior to the world. Veritan speaks of the divine superabundance. The creativity of the artist is indeed a reflection of the inner being of the Godhead. But the effect of this origin and our relation to it is not that we can find something better than the divine artist, artist's generosity. Our own substitutes will leave us only with ourselves. We will be cut off from being, and we will find in reality only ourselves and our own footsteps. The mystical experience, I venture to say, is the revelational answer to that science that purports to recreate a world in man's and not God's image. It is understood, it is concerned with, as Maritain put it, the principle of being with the unity superior to the world. The end for which man was created and elevated was to live the inner life of the Godhead. To contemplate this end strikes me as more exciting and wondrous than any of the humanly made alternatives, however imaginative, however inventive or ingenious or artistic or to family, polis, or the cosmos, so that the creation of what is really, when examined, a greater end or destiny than any of our own creations. The end of the lecture.
We hope you enjoyed listening to Catholic Thinkers. Please visit us at catholicthinkers.org/donate to help us keep this content free.